SpaceX's Starlink constellation is growing, and today we're going to talk about three interesting features that aren't so widely known. Let's go.
Go for deploy. Under speed, lift it to the right level. Contact right.
Hey guys, Tori here from Overlook Horizon. At the time of this recording, SpaceX has launched 955 Starlink satellites into low Earth orbit, starting with the first set back in February 2018. Those two were their early prototypes, named Tintin A and Tintin B. The next 60 were an early version 0.9 model, and the other 893 are all part of the current version 1.0 platform. But it's not like SpaceX hasn't been improving them along the way, and that brings us to feature number one, Linux computers. Each launch of 60 Starlink satellites contains more than 4,000 Linux computers. The constellation has more than 30,000 Linux nodes and more than 6,000 microcontrollers. And this Linux infrastructure is actually shared across SpaceX's other platforms like the Dragon capsule and the Falcon 9 and the Falcon Heavy rockets themselves. So although the Starlink concept is relatively new, a lot of the tech behind it is already well proven. And as a software engineer myself, I find their deployment methods pretty fascinating because they treat each satellite like it's a cloud server in a web service. And what I mean by that is that they are rolling out updates to Starlink satellites every week. They can test software updates on a smaller subset of the constellation and compare performance to the rest of the constellation. And if things don't go well, they can easily just roll back their changes and try again. In fact, most of the time, when a new set of Starlink satellites is launched into orbit, the brand new set of satellites is already a few software versions behind while it was being prepared for launch. But not everything goes to plan, and that brings us to feature number two, autonomous navigation. The team behind SpaceX's Starlink program is relatively small, at least for now. So things like automated orbit guidance and collision avoidance are must-have features. One thing that's pretty neat is that the team tells the batch of satellites what their final orbital slots are, and the satellites figure out how to get there themselves. For collision avoidance, the satellites receive updated data on close approaches with other satellites multiple times a day, and the Starlink satellites then calculate on their own when and how to dodge something, if it's necessary. And on top of all that, the satellites are also designed to passively deorbit if something goes wrong. And not everything has gone perfectly. A few satellites have done exactly that. If one of the satellites doesn't hear from the ground after a long period of time, it will reorient itself into a high drag state, so it can be pulled back by orbital decay and burn up in the atmosphere. During that time, the SpaceX team would keep trying to recover it, but it does ensure that failed units don't stay up there longer than they need to. Each satellite has some redundancies on board to prevent failures, but a lot of the redundancy in the service itself simply relies on end users being able to communicate with multiple satellites at any time. And that brings us to feature number three, the ground station. End users of the Starlink service get their own Starlink antenna that looks something like this. It kind of looks like a UFO, but it's actually pretty sophisticated. First off, the antenna can operate between negative 30 and positive 40 degrees Celsius, but it also has built-in snow melting capabilities, using the heat from the onboard electronics to fight against snow buildup. Also, the ground station has no knowledge of any Starlink satellites when it first powers on. On its first use, it scans the sky in a matter of milliseconds looking for Starlink satellites. Once it locks onto a satellite, it makes a request to join the network, and then the dish is able to download a schedule of which satellites to communicate with next and point in the right direction. And that pointing is probably my favorite feature of the antenna. And that's because this dish is called a phased array antenna. It's actually not one big antenna. It's a whole bunch of little tiny antennas that use software and electronics to direct its transmissions to each Starlink satellite. And this means that it doesn't have to move around all the time. The current for each antenna passes through a phase shifter controlled by a computer. The moving red lines here show the wave fronts of the radio waves emitted by each element. The individual wave fronts are spherical, but they combine in front of the antenna to create a plane wave, a beam of radio waves traveling in a specific direction. The phase shifters delay the radio waves progressively going up the line, so each antenna emits its wavefront later than the one below it. This causes the resulting plane wave to be directed at an angle to the antenna's axis. By changing the phase shifts, the computer can instantly change the angle of the beam. Most phase array antennas have two-dimensional arrays of antennas instead of the linear one that's shown here, and the beam can be steered in two dimensions. This here is another look at a phased array antenna's radiation pattern, where you can see the antenna starts transmitting at a 45-degree angle off of its center, and then almost instantaneously switches to a negative 45-degree angle. Now, Starlink's dish is said to have a field of view of around 100 degrees, and that's on both the X and the Y axis, so it could go about 50 degrees off center in pretty much any direction using just electronics. A YouTuber named Ken actually sacrificed his Starlink antenna and tore the whole thing apart just so you could see the inside and everything happening. If you want to see his expert insight and to see his full hour-long teardown video, check out the link in the description below to see his full video and what's inside a Starlink dish. So that's where I'm going to wrap up today's video. Are you excited about Starlink? Do you think this is something that you could use, like, realistically at home? Let me know in the comments. As always, be sure to click the like button, consider subscribing here, and I'll see you on the next video. Goodbye.